Church, how we doing this morning? Everybody good? Will you stand and worship with us? Before we get started, I want to read you from Psalms 121, verse 1. It says, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. As we sing this song that we've sang a lot of times before, the first line says, let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run. That is why he is the mountain that we run to, because our help comes from him. All right, so let's sing this together.
My God is is holding on to me. God is holding on. When the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. You call the sun to rise, you lay it down to rest, you hold this heart of mine, you hold my every breath. Such an awesome God, so so holy, so wonderful, such an awesome God, so selfless, so jealous, so faithful you are.
Seated in majesty.
Such an awesome God. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. Jesus, the Son of God, hung on a cross to so. comes close to the
kids, you can go ahead and come on up.
Lord, we thank you this morning for each one of these children that you've created, that you've knitted together in their mother's womb, Lord. You knew them before they were even here, and we thank you so much for that, Lord. So we know this morning that you've gone before them. You've prepared the way for them. Lord, this morning I pray that you would transform them by the renewing of their mind. I pray today that they would be hungry for your word. Hungry to know you, Lord. I pray that their hearts would just come alive when they hear the word this morning. I pray for Wayne and as he leads them. Lord, would you empower him by your spirit, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in New Hope. Let it start with these children right here, Lord. We love you and we praise you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good morning. A little louder. Good morning. Welcome. I'm glad you're here, whether you're here in person or joining us online. I'm excited that this morning we get to encounter the one true God. Amen? That's why we're here. And so here's the thing. As we just sang, there's nothing that comes close to your love. I want you to think about that. I want you to think about the things that we've allowed in our lives to rival Him and His goodness in our life. Do you need Him this morning? Do you need Him this morning? More than you need the opinion of your boss, do you need Him this morning? Do you need Him this morning more than you do the approval of your neighbors or your friends? Do you need Him this morning? Amen. More than what your spouse may have said to you this week that rocked your heart, do you need Him more than their opinion? Go, oh, that one's kind of tough. She's right here or he's right here. You know what I'm saying? Like, listen, do you need him? Because he's the healer that writes that stuff. Amen? So right now, let's not play church. Let's not play coy. Let's go before the Lord as if we need him. We need him to step in places that this broken world has assumed that he never intended, that we've been handed. How many of you know it's hard to relate to other people? Why? Because we're selfish. How many of you know you lift your needs before other people just naturally, but he's called you to lift their needs above your own? How many of you right now need the healer to step into your life physically, emotionally, mentally, right now? Because without his help, we don't know how we're going to get through. How many of you are grateful that he makes a way when we can't fathom one on our own? This morning, we get to encounter that God. We get to learn what it means to live in his kingdom. When I'm not patient, let his patience run through me. When I am not strong, let his strength run through me. When I am more proud than I like to admit, but he gives grace to the humble. He lets things in my life come and he humbles me and he shows me how he's carrying me through. Anyone know what I'm talking about? We're encountering that God right now. So Father, we ask that you would come. We ask by your spirit, you would stir in our minds and hearts, fill this place, fill every corridor of our very being, that we would not miss the opportunity right now to meet with Jesus, our healer.
our Savior, our Lord. And we give you this service, we give you our attention, because you didn't call for perfection, you just called for us to come. You loved us when we thought we were unlovable. You're not looking for us, Jesus, to meet some kind of standard or reservation before you love us. You shower us with your love. So shower us with your love right now, because you're so present. May we not miss you in all that you have for us individually and corporately. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand as we continue.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, oh, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so I would. So I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, and I won't be going under. I'm not. Oh, I've never been more.
Put out on the feet of Jesus, our love. our hearts adore you, Jesus. Our hearts adore. Our affection, our devotion, poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion. Put out on the feet of Jesus our affection, our devotion. Put out on the feet of Jesus our affection, our devotion. Put out on the feet of Jesus.
Right there, in that repetition of that chorus, I want you to know that we're not just singing aimlessly. We're not singing mindlessly. We're saying that's our prayer. Many of us have chased other things. We've placed our value, our affection on other things. But Jesus said the greatest commandment is that you'd come after me with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your strength, with all of your soul, that you'd pursue me. This is the first and greatest commandment. David wrote like this. He said in Psalm 42, as the deer pants for water, so my soul pants after you. It longs for you. It needs you. I can't survive without you. There's no life apart from you. I can do no good apart from you. And here's what Jesus says. Matthew 11, he says, come. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle. I'm humble in heart. You will find rest for your very souls. Nothing else on earth promised that. No one else on earth promised that. Rest in the interior. Rest like that called Peter, who had everything the world could offer, and he said, I'd give it all up again for one day with you. I'd give up a lifetime of that for one day here in chains, awaiting to be beheaded, because I have rest for my soul in you and you and you alone. He says, my yoke is easy. My burden for you is light. Can I just ask you, as we step into this time where we're open to the scriptures, are you open today? Is your heart open? How many of you came in and you're heavy? Even if not for your life, for someone in your life, you're heavy. Today, I just pray for you. Jesus, I ask that as we step into this time, may you show yourself to your people. May you reveal yourself even to those who do not know you, but know, may they know that the heaviness doesn't have to continue. May we all know, as you call us into that next step with you, whether for the first time or for the millionth time, Jesus, may we find rest today for our heavy souls. It's found only in you. Speak directly to our need. Use a feeble, wildly imperfect individual as we open the scriptures. Speak directly to the heart of your people, whether in this room or in another room watching online. Jesus, have your way, I pray. In your name. Amen. Well, I am excited today because sharing with you today brings us to a place of close, but with anticipation. We are closing today our series called Counterculture. We have walked through this series now for 8 weeks, and we are coming to the end of Jesus' most famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. And it's so we will wrap this up this week. And it is, let me tell you in advance, with a call to action. How many of you have gotten used to, you've been doing the church thing for a while? Everyone raise your hand, know what I'm talking. Okay, at the end of the service, we have like a response time or an invitation to respond, and we call it here worship with action. Maybe you've heard it in the days of old, an invitation. Well, Jesus ends his most famous sermon in the same way. We kind of learned it from him, okay? Is that all right? Amen? Okay, we learned it from him. So next week, I am anticipating jumping into our next series for 4 weeks. We're going to walk towards the cross as we get ready for Easter in a series I'm calling Kingdom Come. So we have been walking for the past 8 weeks through a series called Counterculture, where he's taught us, where the thing that Jesus taught a lot about in his ministry, as much as he taught about anything else, he spoke of the kingdom. And he teaches us what it looks like to live his kingdom. And then next week, we're going to beg for his kingdom to come. So as we're wrapping up this most famous sermon, Jesus is summarizing all that he's been teaching about the upside down kingdom that is his kingdom, one that is not like our world whatsoever. He starts at the Beatitudes, and he walks us through, like we looked at last week, to the gate, the very narrow gate, that turnstile that is himself. And he says that we have a choice. The action is to choose his way, to build our life upon his words in his way. And it's only done by turning and trusting again him versus our own way. And how many of you have become pretty comfortable in your way? It's okay to be honest about that. Jesus knows already. Okay? I would say, and we'll get into this in a moment, that the only way that we truly step into his way is by abandoning altogether our own. So let's read on. Here we go. In Matthew 7, the final 5 verses of the Sermon on the Mount says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house upon the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. The rains came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash." Verse 28, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as one of the teachers of the law. So if I were to quantify where Jesus is wrapping up here, he's wrapping up the entire sermon in these 5 verses from the start of the Beatitudes to now. But I would also say a little further, we looked at last week what often people refer to as the most scary verse in all of Scripture. But it's not scary for anyone who's truly a part of his kingdom, who've truly trusted him, who are not trusting on their own self-righteousness, but they've walked through that turnstile, never looking back. And Jesus says, in order to do that, in order to walk through a turnstile, a narrow gate, you can't walk back through. You have to leave your baggage at the door. But the beauty of this is when we leave our baggage at the door, we leave it outside. We walk through as innocently, as exposed and vulnerable as we possibly can. We walk straight into his embrace. We walk straight into his embrace and his perfect way for us, which is what Matthew 11 says. So I want to share with you about someone who made that decision just a few weeks ago. I shared about this, but I've been saving this text that was sent to me soon after. I said there was a young man who came who had been wildly religious and found in one sermon, one day God was just beckoning his heart, and he came to the front, and I said, "God has been speaking to you, isn't he?" He said, "Yes." I said, you are wildly religious. You've been doing that a long time, but you are having Jesus call you to himself, aren't you? And he goes, 100%. Do you want Jesus? Because he surely wants you. And he goes, 100%. A couple days after that exchange, we prayed. He trusted the Lord upon stepping in. He texted me. Now, context, he's an engineer, okay? That's what he does. He's an engineer. And he texts me this text. Listen, I wonder if this is important to you as it was to me, specifically given this passage. I knew this passage was coming. He says this: "Man, God is talking to me. I'm in a concrete pipe class, and the presenter just said, until a foundation has been corrected, nothing good will happen that is built on it until it's fixed. And my first thought had nothing to do with engineering, but everything to do with me and him, and without his foundation, nothing good can be built." Amen? Amen. Dude, I'm so excited about that. Like, I'm listening to this, and he's going, you know what? I may have thought I had a bedrock established for my life, but it was sand. Many people believe, you know what? I'm going to kind of step into the Jesus thing and, like, tiptoe on the Jesus thing. If this were a river, I'm going to kind of like put my toe in, but I'm going to stay firmly on the bank, you know, and kind of live in two worlds. How many of you think you can build a house on two separate foundations in that house stand? He says, if that house foundation has any crack within it, that house is going to fall. So here's the picture of what my friend just told us. You can't straddle the fence, just like Jesus said, I'd rather be hot or cold. You can't live in two worlds. You can't place yourself solely on this foundation and acting like you're on that one. You are either in or you're out. There is no sitting on the bank. There is no tiptoeing in. There's no wading into the water and holding onto a root system so you don't get swept away. When it is placing your foundation in Jesus, it is. That river of God flows straight from the throne of heaven, and Jesus is that river, and we jump in head first, immersed completely, following wherever he'll wildly take us. It is trusting that he is best, and he leads to best for us. So the first point that I want to give you is that we are called to practice the way of Jesus, and to do so, you have to be done with your way. In order to truly trust Jesus and practice his way, you got to be done with yours. Lordship means boss. You know who taught me that? I was serving at a church in Florida, and a four-year-old came to me and said, I'm ready to be baptized. Parents sat me down with her. We were talking through it, and I said, what do you think it means for Jesus to be Savior? She goes, well, and she told me language that many would respond to about the cross. And I said, okay. But the Bible also says that if he's Savior, he is Lord. And in fact, the scriptures reveal that every knee will bow, every tongue confess one day that Jesus is Lord. So whether you acknowledge that right now or not, he is Lord. We get to choose to acknowledge him as Lord right now, or in the end, we'll all acknowledge. But if you choose now, you'll be with him in the end. So what does Lord mean? She goes, that means boss. And I was like, that is one of the best answers I've ever heard. You're exactly right. That means you don't do anything without checking with him first. You run every decision through him. I have a way, but I must unlearn my way in order to practice my boss's way. I have a way, but I have to unwire, I have to unhinge, I have to unlearn what I have learned in order to do it his way. First of all, this verse is communicating something that I need to be clear. Last week we learned that you can choose many roads, but Jesus has one road. Amen? The Father had one plan. It was in his Son, Jesus. And many roads, man can choose whatever road he wants, worldly or wildly self-righteous and religious, but all have the same end. Here, Jesus goes far more specific because he's really concerned for them about who has been their religious example, and he closes his most famous sermon by highlighting, let's put the worldly aside, because I think we all agree. I think we all recognize that that is wrong. I think we all recognize that trusting in a world that's temporal and it's going to pass and it's fleshly and completely selfish, that's wrong. So let me go ahead and highlight. He goes, let me highlight what you think is godly, but denies the power of God, as 2 Timothy says. Listen to these words. Everyone who hears these words of mine. So what Jesus is saying, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into action, verse 26, everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice. What this assumes is that both men begin to build, but both men understand and have heard his words. Here, in this text, this is not someone who does not know his words. This is everyone who has heard his words, and they choose. They make a choice. So this is for everyone who's heard his words, so much so that they can tell you, like he did, the way of salvation. They can repeat for you his words, and both start building their life. One upon Christ's teaching, as if it were a guiding way, and their life is now treating him as boss, and they're doing everything they can as worship of him. Everything. There is nothing else. It's not just gathering on Sunday as worship. It's in everything they do, worship. And the other has an appearance of that, but begins to build upon himself. The second doesn't intentionally strive to build a house or a life. Listen, doesn't intentionally do it. That will fall. Who would do that? This means no. Okay? No one would do that. So what Jesus is saying is, this person thinks they are safe because they have heard and acknowledged Jesus' words, can even repeat them, but builds his life in the worship of self, and thus his foundation is solely self. As we discussed last week, this challenge of verse 24 beckons that we do more than simply hear his words. Ponder them and give mental acknowledgement towards those words. This verse commands action. And the first action is to choose. Choose who this day whom you're going to serve. Choose this day what foundation you're building on. So both men built with confidence that their house will stand. One in the confidence of what Christ had done and what he said, his work. The other in his own. We choose his way over our own. There's a passage that show. I want to give you some words that I like. I call it coming to the end of yourself. Coming to the end of yourself. Have you come to the end of yourself? In Jonah 2, inside the belly of the whale, Jonah prays inside the belly of this fish that he had no idea was coming. The end of Jonah 1, he's thrown over the side unto his death just to salvage everyone else. But he prays this. Listen to this prayer. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God and said, in my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From the depths of the grave, I called for help, and you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the deep, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled about me. All the waves and breakers swept over me. I said that I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again towards your holy temple. The engulfing waters threatened me, and the deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down, but the earth beneath barred me in forever. But you brought my life up from the pit, O Lord my God. Despite all that was happening, and despite all I had earned, you still brought me up. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord. My prayers rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. But I, with a song of thanksgiving and sacrifice unto you, I vow that I will make good. I will make good. Salvation comes from the Lord alone. And then it says that the fish was commanded by the Lord to spit him onto dry land. Listen, whether you take that as literal or metaphoric allegory, doesn't matter. Here's the reality. The truth is, the moral is the same. We all must come to the end of ourselves. And right here, you're seeing a prayer that has been penned, canonized, inspired by the Spirit of God Himself that says, look, I had a way, but in order to practice His way, my way has to end entirely. It can't have any remnant of my way. It's got to go. How many of you have had that end? Now, let me ask you a question, just being honest. Like, how many of you know a friend, not you, but know a friend who've prayed this kind of prayer before, but they didn't really mean it? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's okay. We're all, well, most of us are adults. Here it is. How many of you have a friend who had a bad night with alcohol, found themselves over the commode all night, and said, God, I'll never drink again. Just get me through this. And was that the end? I didn't say, you know your friend. I don't know your friend. That wasn't the end. They're just like, get me out of this. Get me through it. And the whole time God was saying, I'm trying to get through to you in this. We go, God, if you're so good, why do you use crisis? So you'll turn to me. God, if you're so good, why'd this happen? Because I want you to see what you can get you and go, I can't do anything. I'm desperate. And he goes, that prayer over that commode sounds a whole lot like the prayer that you should be praying, but with sincerity. Not coming to me so I can help you, coming to me so I can save you. Not just getting you through it. Not just getting you out in a moment. That your life won't have to hurt. Your life won't have to turn to agents of the world any longer. Your life can trust me more than you can trust any of this temporal stuff that's fading away that brought you to this place. You worship the idols this world offers. And Jonah says, they turn to idols, forfeiting the grace that could be theirs. You choose. It's your first action. We choose to practice His way of our own. And when we choose His way, we choose wisely. The second action is to practice. And when we do, we build upon Jesus' words. Jesus begins to build our lives upon an unshakable foundation in Him. We read this last week. You're already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. He said this to His disciples. Like, there's nothing more for you to do. You're already clean. Like, I did that. An eternal foundation that can never be shaken. 1 John 2 says this, by this we know that we are in Him. The one who says that he abides in Him ought to walk in the same manner as Jesus walked. So what is the practice? Everything that he's been preaching for the past two chapters that we've been looking at for 8 weeks in Matthew 5 through 7. He's describing what his kingdom looks like and what it means to be solely found in Him, and how counter to everything the world offers truly is. It begins with the Beatitudes, and He explains persecution for choosing His way, and that we are to love even our enemy. Like, He's saying, look, my people are humble. My people will be persecuted. My people are going to walk through it because there's a storm in this life, and I know that you're going to have trouble, but my people get through it and see me on the end, because my people know this is passing away. This is temporal. And so even if they're persecuted, I'm going to bring them through. I'm going to give them the ability to love the one who's bringing persecution upon them. Hello? When their love previous to me was limited, how many of you had limited love? How many of you were even a little like vicious apart from Jesus? Like, you liked vengeance, you like to seek your own justice. If someone's not going to act on my behalf, I'll act on my own behalf. Anyone like that? He goes, these people know that they don't need to take vengeance into their own hands. They know that justice and vengeance is mine. I have been, I am, and will fight for my people. His way, his kingdom, is truly counter to anything we understand in culture, whether worldly or debaucherous or self-righteous and religious and moral, which is what he's going to talk about right here. Both have that same end. Both lead to destruction. While Jesus says, my kingdom will stand forever. And what did Jesus say about his kingdom and who, where the first finish? The first in this world finish where in his kingdom? Think about that. So those who finish first here on earth finish last in this kingdom. But he says, those who will finish last in my kingdom, my people, those who are given the strength, who maybe have a crippled exterior, they have the inner grip of my spirit within them. Like those people who lift everyone else's needs above their own, who literally love and give the shirt off their back. They give and give and give just so that other people can benefit. Those people have a perspective that is my perspective. They just want to love everyone as selflessly as I did. And those people, they finish first in my kingdom. The last shall be first. Does that make sense? This means no. That doesn't make sense to us. It's not logical. That's upside down. But the more you give away, the more you make it about him and less about yourself, the more you move through this life into eternity towards the finish line. And he goes, you made it first. Whatever you do, the least of these, you've done unto me. So you look around you and you go, how many of you, it's easy to point out the homeless. It's easy to point out the hurting. It's easy to point out those who might be mentally unstable. It's easy to point those out. He goes, you love them like I would selflessly. You're about my kingdom. You're finishing first in my kingdom. That's it. Lift their needs above your own. But what about those people that look a little more stable, but they are spiritually bankrupt? They live in a house that no one would recognize that they're bankrupt. They live in a marriage with children, and no one will recognize they're spiritually bankrupt. They have everyone fooled. You lift their needs above your own. You speak into that life. You see what they're dealing with. You gaze into the soul because the Spirit of God indwells you and makes you aware. And you speak directly to their need and to their heart. Because you'll finish first. John 16:33, I have told you these things that in me you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble, and so will your neighbors who know me and don't know me. But take heart, because you know me, and I have overcome the world. Next point, here it is. Jesus is saying, there will be storms. But I'm going to give you a little secret. With what he just said in John 16:33, life is a storm. Sometimes we're just more cognizant of the waves being higher than others. It's never not a storm. For anyone who's in Jesus, you live so counter to this culture, you're called to be about his kingdom, which is upside down to everything the world teaches. You're never not going to be in a storm. You'll be swimming upstream for the rest of your days here. In this life, you will have trouble. In this life, that is promised. It is one big storm of brokenness beating against our lives, seeking to devour us, but for the one who's built his trust upon Jesus' work and seeks to bear fruit of his spirit, emulating Jesus' life, his love, you'll endure. The house, your life. That's what this illustration is about. It's about you. What your life is built upon will stand. This life, in the storms therein, are unavoidable. Let me take this illustration a little closer with the whole house thing, okay? They're unavoidable. In these two verses, Jesus repeats himself for emphasis. He says about the house, about everyone who hears twice because it's emphatic. He's declaring that you can choose what you'll trust in, but the choice determines your end. It's gonna be his way or your way. And he's speaking more to the religious because he's saying everyone who's heard this. Now that you've heard it, you're accountable for what you do with it. This passage is assuming even all the more that one's foundation will fall when it is built upon religion or self-righteousness. In this passage, Jesus is giving this away to a people who are listening. And when he gives this away, the illustration would assume that he's talking about people who live in the same community. And they're facing the same storm. Now, we're all going to face a storm. We live it. It doesn't matter. Whether it was then, now, or tomorrow, we're all going to face a storm. And in the end, every knee bow, every tongue confess. But this world, he said, you'll have trouble. We'll all face a storm. But right here, let's get more specific. Jesus is saying, let's imagine there was no escape. And these two houses, much like the two apples I started this series with, one full of fruit, one full of wax, look the same on the exterior. And they're facing the same storm. It's beating against them, and only one is going to stand. What he's saying is this. We need to consider that his illustration points to them living in the very same way. Both are religious. This isn't worldly. He's saying, you heard my words. Both have an orthodox in theology that is the same. Both attending the same church. Both listening to the same preaching. Both attending the same Bible study. Both serving in that same church. Both supporting that same church financially. Both having the same friends. Living in the same neighborhoods. Living in the same community. Both having and being responsible citizens for their community. Yet two incredibly different ends. The tares among the wheat. This is what Jesus is saying in this close to his most famous sermon ever given. He calls to action. He goes, you might fool everyone else, but I know the heart. I don't look at the exterior like everyone else does. So your house can look just like everyone else's on your block. But the foundation is weak because it's built on you. It's built on sand. It will falter because this storm is coming. And when that storm comes and beats against the house and the water rises and the rains come, this one will collapse, but the other one will not because it was true. It wasn't artificial. So I need every single person who has been raised in a religious, culturally religious environment where you've been doing the church thing for a long time. Can I ask you, why do you think I say this all the time? Our vision verse that I shared, Matthew 11, is come to me. Who do we invite to? Do we say come to New Hope? No, that vision verse is driven by come to Jesus. It doesn't matter how long you've been attending a church. For the first time or the millionth. You might even be deceiving yourself that you are safe. But your foundation is actually you, not him. And he says, depart from me, I never knew you. I'd rather you be hot or cold than try to straddle these fences. I'd rather you live like hell now and live it up so that you don't suffer the end, because the end, if it's not me, if I don't cloak you, if you don't implicitly trust me, walk through that turnstile leaving everything else behind, you won't have me. You'll be separate of me for all time. It doesn't matter how many times you did this. And so it's not terrifying for the person who walks through that turnstile and knows it, not just because they can repeat the way of salvation and not just because they can repeat how to get to Jesus. It's because they are in Jesus. Those who are in Jesus have no fear. In the end, he goes, well done, my good and faithful servant. And all we do in listening to this sermon is step into that next place of surrender with him, where we start lifting others' needs above our own and living like that, because we're trying to finish last here so we can be first there. But the person who goes, I've been doing this a long time and I can repeat it the way that they want me to repeat it. I can say it the way that they want me to say it, and I'm going to study, I'm doing all this, but there's something's missing. I still don't feel at peace. Yeah. Yeah. It's hard. It's hard to teach church members what it means to be a follower of Jesus. But Jesus is talking about the church. They lived in the same community, same orthodoxy and theology, same preaching every week, same Bible study, but when this stuff went forward, it was hitting stone. Dude, let me be clear. It is heartbreaking to think that all that goes forth is hitting stone. And I'm not, Jesus knew what was coming. He said, there will be tares among the wheat that'll grow up together, and it won't be till the end, till the sifting, that you'll be able to see who was mine and who wasn't. But you get to choose first on whom you'll build your foundation. His word or your opinion. Doesn't matter how you practice, because the practices can look the same. The exterior can look the same. But if you build your foundation upon what he has said, they're already clean by the word I've spoken to you. And then out of that, you worship him with your life versus worshiping self. Then you have nothing to fear. You are truly his. But if you go, I have done this so long, and I have this exterior, but I feel dead inside. He goes, ding, ding, ding. That's why this is speaking directly to you. So here's the point, the third point. Jesus' teaching and way are our authority. It's the only way through the storm. How many of you are grateful that if Jesus said, you have a problem, you live in a broken world, but I'm going to fix that problem. God had a plan, it was one way, and it was a single way. How many of you are grateful that God didn't leave us out here on our own? That he intervened. And he goes, I don't want you interfering with where I'm moving, because I want people who truly know me, who truly love me, who truly want to see others know the hope they can have in me, to come to the forefront. I want them to come to the forefront by being last. I want them to come to the forefront in the minds of those who do not know me and those who just are playing the part to get out of the way. I want light to blow back darkness so that others who don't know me can have hope. I want them to know that one way, not many ways. Many ways lead to destruction. One way, a narrow, if you find it, lead unto righteousness. This is that decision to walk through the turnstile. So this verse right here, in the end, it says this. When Jesus had finished saying these things, verse 28, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught with authority and not as the teachers of the law. See, in his day, many rabbis and scribes, they do this today. They would quote other rabbis to lend authority to their teaching. But here's what Jesus did. It was different. He taught only the scriptures and did so with authority as to establish himself as the final authority on said scriptures. So, like, if you went to a rabbinical teaching, if you went to a synagogue, you sat there, you would find a teacher of the law reclining, sitting down, and he's just like, they're asking questions and he's answering. And he would say, well, Rabbi Hillel says this, and Rabbi So says this, as to solidify their opinion. Jesus teaches this entire sermon, and it amazed everyone because they had never heard anyone teach like that. And he says, no, this is the truth. I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Doesn't matter what you've been taught, doesn't matter how you've heard it before. I'm here now changing everything. I've taken the culture, I've shaken it down, I've taken the walls of religion, broken those down too, and now you have direct access to the Father through me. Despite what you've heard, and despite what anyone else used to affirm their authority, I don't need anyone else's lending. I'm gonna quote the scriptures because those scriptures are talking about me. I'm going to quote the scriptures with authority because those scriptures were inspired by my very spirit. And that spirit will raise me from the grave so that you can have hope. And that spirit will be placed in you because of what I'm about to do for you on the cross. And that is the only way. That was God's plan, but that's the only way through this storm. It isn't about anything you'll do self-righteously. You're not earning any of this. But it's going to take all your effort to throw your way aside and to trust mine. God's never been opposed to effort. He's opposed to earning. The true mark of a disciple is not simply hearing and believing, acknowledging in the mind, even able to repeat it the way someone told you it, but rather by believing and trusting in the heart, Romans 10:9 and 10 says, and then by doing. Doing what he says as worship, not in fear, as if I'm earning something, not doing a lot of good things as to make an account and hopefully Jesus remembers. He says, look, I see what others don't. So what you thought went unnoticed, I saw your mind, I saw your heart, I saw the way that you gave, whether it was joyful or not. I saw when you stopped and had prayer with that homeless person and the cameras weren't on and no one else saw that. Because I moved on your heart and you stopped to sit with them as worship unto me. I saw when you couldn't help because you knew your neighbor was going through a divorce that you went over, baked cookies, and just sat to pray with them. I saw what didn't need to be put on display. I saw you love and be light just like me as my ambassador when it seemed like they were consumed by darkness. Hello? James 1:22 says this, that true disciples of Jesus converted into new life by the gospel are doers of the word and not hearers only. And listen, who delude themselves. That's scary. He goes, true disciples of Jesus are those who hear what Jesus said and they act upon it as worship of him, not simply deceiving themselves as hearers only. 1 John 2 says, whoever keeps my word, in him the love of God has truly been perfected. Jesus said, I am the truth, I'm the way, and I am alone life. You can't live apart from me. You can't produce or do any good apart from me. Scripture reveals that whether we acknowledge him this way or not, every single person one day will confess him as Lord in the end. So here's the deal. What that means is this, that if he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, then he's Lord right now. It doesn't matter whether we acknowledge him. One day, literally, everyone who's ever been here, everyone who exists in the end will go, you are Lord. They'll all say it. But is he Lord right now? Whether you acknowledge it or not, is he Lord? Is he Lord right now?
Yes.
That's better. Was he Lord yesterday?
Yes.
Absolutely. So he is Lord whether we choose to accept and acknowledge that or not. He is boss because the Father made him boss. And he's the only way through. We choose to accept and surrender to that reality right here, right now. When we choose that his way is best, it is only. We're willing to establish our life on his teachings and his practices. That we're not just going to hear, we're not just going to acknowledge, and like stone let it bounce off of us. We're going to do it because we're joining him as worship. So this morning, the question I ask you is this. Do you choose him? Do you choose his way this morning? The only way that we truly choose his way is by being done with our own. Like slaying that decision. Like letting that old life truly pass away and follow him implicitly into the new, taking nothing with us, no baggage, walking through that turnstile as naked and vulnerable as possible again, going, God, I need your embrace. I need you in my life. I need you to intervene in so many places. And you know what? Most of all is like to clean up what I've done in my own way. You clean it up. Work through me. Lead me. I'll do whatever you ask because I want to do it as worship unto you. Whether I'm sitting in a pew or sitting in a cubicle or in a classroom or at home, God, everything I do and every choice I make is for you. I'm going to ask, seek, knock. Where can you use me? How can you use me in the life of another? How can I minister and be an ambassador of your kingdom? Because if I don't, They have no hope. You are Lord. The only way they're going to know is if I live as if you're Lord. Hello? So this morning, do you choose him or his way? Are you going to continue to do yours? I had an atheist ask me one time who admitted that he was miserable. He said, I'm in this loveless marriage. My wife hates me. My kid can't stand me. I'm in this dead-end job. I feel like my life's going nowhere. And I said, why are you telling me this? This is like our second conversation, like ever. He goes, I don't know. I felt like you'd listen. I said, no, there's a reason you're telling me this, but I need you to acknowledge it. And he goes, what is it? I said, so you're an atheist. Yeah. You chose there's no God. He's like, well, I didn't choose there's no God. I just don't, you know. No, here's the thing. I'm not an atheist, and I chose that there is a God. So we had a choice. So you chose there's no God. Okay, yeah, I guess, yeah, you put it that way. Yeah. I said, okay, so who's that make you? He's like, human? I was like, no, no, no. I didn't ask what that makes you. I asked, who does that make you? If you are the final authority on all things deity, who are you? He goes, well, I'm God. I said, yeah. And you just admitted you're miserable. This is what worship of your God gets you. Are you done with that yet? He goes, I've never had anyone say it like that. I think I am. And right there in that coffee shop, gave his life to the Lord. Here's the thing. That little had nothing to do with me. It had everything to do with what the Lord was doing in him. Let me ask you, what is the Lord doing in you right now? And are you done with trusting your way? Here's the thing. It doesn't matter if you feel like, yes, I've trusted Jesus and I've trusted. I want you to think about your week. Did you treat your boss like worship of Jesus? Did you treat your employees like you were worshiping Jesus when you approached them? Did you talk to your kids like as worship of Jesus, your wife or your husband as worship of Jesus and not yourself? Where can you turn again today and just trust him all the more, turning your back on your own way? That's why we gather here, to press in more to him. It's to abandon every single week, every minute. He said, only my true disciples take up their cross every single day and come after me. So I got to tell you, I don't think Jesus went far enough with that. He said every day, man, I know me. How many of you like me? It's got to be like every second. Like, forgive me, Lord. I'm pressing into you because my way is pretty strong. How many of you, be honest, like, I love my way. Come on, be honest. You might love some people in this room, but you love you. For the first or for the millionth time, will you respond and choose his way? If you're here today, you can show your trust of him and his way by giving. You know, we show a lot of what we trust. That's why Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. Either serve me or you'll serve stuff. So today, we treat this as an act of worship. It's an opportunity to respond to Jesus. The box in the back, the QR codes in front of you, when you give, you're saying, my hope is not in this stuff. It's not in my wallet. It's in him. And he gave this to me anyway, so I want to give it back to him. I want my neighbors to know the truth of the gospel. I want Kenyans to know the truth of the gospel. My hope's not built on anything but him. This morning, maybe you're here and you go, I need to sit at the altar today. And I just need to let God, move on my heart. I want to put it down physically. Like, I want to show, like, proskuneo, like a ground kisser, like I'm on my face going, positioning my heart where it should be, beneath you, not above you, beneath you. And if you're here and you go, I need the Lord and I got to do some business with the Lord by myself right here. If you go, I have not treated the people in my life the way Jesus would, I have not been worshiping him in my interaction with others, and I need someone to just pray for me because I'm hurting on that right here. I need Jesus to intervene because I don't know how he's going to beat this cancer. I need someone praying for me here. Here, on your own, here, trusting others to lift that before the Lord. You don't have to tell them what you're praying. You're just saying vulnerably, I need help with this. How many of you need help with this? That's every hand. Today, if you're here and you go, I want to thank him. I want to thank him that he called me to walk through that turnstile a long time ago by his Spirit. I want to thank him because he worked in my life just like he was that guy in the coffee shop that Justin just mentioned. I want to thank him. And so today, I remember his body that was broken for me. I remember his blood that atoned for my sin, what I earned, and it washed me white as snow, and he gave me a fresh start. I want to thank him for that. You can come to the community. As worship of him, because when you do, you're saying, if my body be broken and my blood be spilled, if I end up last, so be it, because it's not about me. Maybe you say, I need to be praying for some people in my life that he's trusted to me. And I want to choose his way in their lives, but can I just be honest? I'm prone to choose my own way. Maybe today you go, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Anyone know what I'm talking about? Prone to wander right back, thinking I can go back to the turnstile, go back to my old way. I'm prone to look that way. So today in this person's life, God, don't let me turn to my way. Let me trust your way. Write that down, put it in the jar. I will literally pray over that if you want me to. I'll pray for that. You can put it there. You can pin it to the cross and I won't touch it. That's between you and him. But I keep going at this person in my way. And I want them to see you. I'm done. I'm done. So Jesus, this morning, whether for the first time or for the millionth, may we, your church, respond to you. We have built our lives on something, and you alone know what we've built upon. Today, may we press all the further in to the foundation of you, leaving behind what we have built, so that Jesus, the world around us, can have hope. You ended your sermon with a call to action, to choose and to do upon the words that you gave away. You called for practice. We first choose and then we practice. So Jesus, right now in this room, don't let us worry about anyone else in this room or how they respond. Jesus, be very clear and specific with us about how you want me right now to respond to you. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. There should be, I want you to know. Can I ask, here's how I know. How many of you have had Jesus speak to you about something right now? Just raise your hand real quick. Just a little bit higher. I want everyone to see this. What does he want you to do with that? This altar's open. The cross is open. The jars are open. The communion table is open. I'll be right here if you need something to pray with. If you're here and you go, I want Jesus, and I'm coming for the first time, I'll be right here. Let's stand. Let's respond to Jesus.
See, my hope is built on nothing less. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing that again.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord, Lord.
Sing that again.
Oh, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, and Savior.
Go. like Jesus in the garden, wants you to take this cup from me. Like Jesus in the garden, you don't call where you won't leave. I wanna love like you love, wanna bleed like you bleed. I don't wanna go if you're not going before me. I don't wanna go if you're not going before me. I don't wanna go if you're not going before me. I don't wanna go if you're not going before me.
You know what the good news is? He's promised to go before us. Amen? Amen? He's not going to call you into anything where he's not leading. So right now, as he's speaking to your heart about who you can be, his representation, who you can love like he would, who you can be light in the darkness like he is, he's already starting to stir in their heart because he's started moving on yours. Amen? How many of you want to see Hermitage become like heaven? Amen? I don't think he's done working in Hermitage, but we'll start there. Okay? We'll start with your immediate contact, your immediate touch. Jesus, we love you. We thank you so much for loving us. We thank you so much for giving us each other, for giving us yourself. Thank you for the invitation to come to you, to become like you, to be who you've called us to be. We want to live like your kingdom, and we want others to have hope of life renewed in you and in you alone. Jesus, let us carry your heart. Show us how our hands and feet need to move. Give us the words. Continue to speak to us. We pray. We're listening. It's in your name we ask. Amen. Amen. Just before we go, you guys can have a seat. I got a couple things to share with you, if it's okay. So, first of all, you probably noticed those bags on the end of your pew this week, okay? And if you notice those bags, they are decorated, and they've been decorated by our children's ministry. Amen? Cool? All right? So you see that these beautiful bags have been decorated by our children's ministry, and they serve an intention. It is where you can join with our church to serve children in all of our community as we inch towards Easter. So we want you to take these bags. We want every bag taken today. And we want you to take those, and we want you to go fill those up with candy. Okay, we want you to go fill those up with candy bags to go in those bags so that when we do our treasure hunt, our egg hunt on the day right before Easter, April 16th, there's going to be tons, just a plethora of candy to give away to our community. Not because we're trying to rot their teeth. We want to give a tangible evidence that there's treasure for them to be found, not just in candy, ultimately in Jesus and Jesus alone. That's what we're going to celebrate that weekend, okay? So you can help us with that. So take that, fill it up. You can bring it back. There's a black table out in the foyer. It's right as you come in. We're going to we'll take those up this next Sunday, April 3rd and April 10th, okay? So over the course of the next 2 weeks, bring it back to us, all right? And just leave them right there. We'll take care of it. Speaking of April 3rd, you may have seen my video on Friday. I want to let you know about an opportunity. Isaiah House is kicking off here in Davidson County on April 3rd at 3 o'clock. It's at the Margaret Maddox YMCA in East Nashville. And as a member, I've been asked, as a member of the team that's helping initiate and kind of getting involved with this ministry, I was asked, about how many people do you think are going to come from New Hope? And I said, I really don't know. We've had so many people excited and showing interest. I don't know what to tell them. What should I tell them? Okay, so five. Okay, I'll let them know. What should I tell them? They called and asked, can you bring some extra chairs? Because we hope this place will be flowing with people, and we have too many people. We have to hold two of these kickoffs because we can't fit everyone in. I said, I don't know what to tell you. I just think there's a lot of interest from New Hope, and hopefully it's more than five. Amen? Amen? This is an opportunity for us to serve a specific type of child right here in our city. Jesus said, you'll be my witnesses unto Jerusalem, your city. This is it. We get to start right here. So I'm excited. April 3rd at 3. That's next Sunday, 3 o'clock. And if you're not sure where Margaret Maddox YMCA is, look on Google. They'll tell you. It's 2624 Gallatin Pike. I'm going to introduce to you some people who have believed upon what God is doing here at New Hope. They've believed on where the Lord is leading us. They want to see us see Hermitage become like heaven and beyond. They want to get involved in places like Isaiah House. They want to help with children here in our community and children and people on the other side of the globe. And so they've come today to covenant with New Hope, and we're going to introduce you to them. So I'm going to bring their names up on the screen, and I'm going to ask them to come and stand here along the altar. And as they make their way, we're going to celebrate them. Ariel Berry is coming today. Terry Blevins is coming today. Diane and Lewis Boer are coming today. Andy Depew is coming today. Christy Evers and Kaylin Evers are coming today. Amen? Are you excited about that? I'm excited about that. So, here's what we want you to do. In a moment, we're going to dismiss you officially, and you're going to come by, and we just want you to welcome them. We want you to make them feel at home right here. That you've made the decision to cover this place, and you're glad that they're making the decision. We're going to lock arms and take Hermitage. We're going to take Hermitage for Jesus. Amen? We're going to see heaven extend from not just this corner, but to all ends of the earth. Oh, and one of the ways we're going to do it, I just want to let you know, as you're getting anticipated this week, we're going to be right here at 6:30 in this room on Wednesday night for prayer meeting. Amen? So if you've not been, you need to be right here. We're going to seek the Lord and let His Spirit lead us together. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for loving us. We ask that today, as we leave this place, we would just be accurate ambassadors of your kingdom. Thank you for Jesus. May we live and love like Him today. It's in His name we ask. Amen. You are dismissed. Come and greet these.